Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Temple and the Lodge, the strange and fascinating history of the Knights Templar and the Freemasons, by Michael Baigent and Richard Leigh. Foreword by Mitch Horowitz. Narrated by Rick Adamson. Foreword. Esoteric History and Our History: Rediscovering the Temple and the Lodge. I originally encountered the Temple and the Lodge during my first job in publishing in 1989. I was asked to prepare a reader's report on whether the book would make a good paperback reprint. I didn't get it. Like many young people, I entered the world of literature with almost no understanding of, and even less interest in, Freemasonry, Knights Templar, and esoteric philosophies. I do not recall such topics ever coming up in college. More than a decade later, when I began my own journey into chronicling occult history, you can never foresee your path, Michael Baigent and Richard Leigh's book returned to me with new relevance, and the authors themselves returned to bestseller lists, famous for their earlier work, Holy Blood, Holy Grail, which contributed to the historical template of Dan Brown's The Da Vinci Code. Our culture seems to thrive on a process of embrace and backlash, and this cycle played out in the careers of Baigent and Leigh. Following the 2003 publication of Brown's novel, Baigent and Leigh were, for a time, feted, widely read, and discussed, and then came the axe of counter-criticism, accusing them of historical fallacies and speculations. The writers sued Brown's publisher for copyright infringement, claiming the Da Vinci Code appropriated the architecture of their work. They lost, incurring millions in legal debt. It is my hope that this new publication of The Temple and the Lodge properly returns the reading public's gaze to where it belongs, the intrepid historicism and investigatory skills of these now deceased authors. Leigh passed in 2007 and Baigent in 2013. It is unnecessary to agree with all of the author's historical suppositions, I do not, to recognize their prowess as researchers. Very few of the bloggers and knights of Wikipedia who rush to label Baigent and Leigh's work as speculative history recognize or possess the author's documentary skills and grasp of detail. Were the pair alive, I think they would like the label investigative history. In my not-quite-Solomonic effort, I call their work theoretical history. Baigent and Leigh's historicism necessarily incorporates their own, often spiritedly argued, theses. But it is important to note that the authors were not insistent in tone and openly acknowledged their uncertainties, a vanishing trait in today's culture. The pair brought prodigious effort and fieldwork to The Temple and the Lodge, which explores the survival of esoteric thought systems, in particular the origins of modern Freemasonry within the Knights Templar, a marshal and banking order brutally suppressed by the Vatican in the early 14th century. Freemasonry is itself profoundly uncertain of its own origins, the authors note. That important point fuels investigations like this one. When approaching esoteric history, few maps exist. The seeker is his own cartographer. Baigent and Leigh approached this challenge with poise and dedication, if not always in a manner bound to settle arguments. Although I write as a historian who shares the author's Masonic sympathies, I believe that Baigent and Leigh placed too much stock in secret historical retentions, by which I mean the concealment and preservation of hidden bloodlines and traditions within highly placed families and social cliques. Frankly, I detect little direct inheritance of esoteric traditions within the contemporary world. History is messy, and family trees, especially family trees of ideas, rarely reach us intact. More common are self-styled secret societies, which pretend to ancient ties and whose acolytes sometimes unknowingly rely on hidden wisdom of no greater vintage than the occult revival of the mid to late 19th century. None of this means that Baigent and Leigh were wrong about lingering and even seismic effects of occult philosophies. Ideas, symbols, practices, and insights not only endure across time, but sometimes form unseen foundations. This is especially true of Freemasonic influences. Do you doubt that? Just look at the back of a dollar bill. The eye and pyramid is not a direct leaf from Masonry, but reflects Masonic philosophy to the core. Material life, the pyramid, is incomplete without the eye of providence. In the Temple and the Lodge, Baigent and Leigh creditably explore Freemasonic influences on America's framers and revolutionists, a fact of history that most mainstream historians, until recently, underappreciated or overlooked. In the American colonies, fraternity outweighed philosophy. Most colonists did not actually read Locke, Hume, Voltaire, Diderot, Rousseau any more than most British soldiers did, Baigent and Leigh write. But a significant number of thought leaders, including Washington, Franklin, and Hancock, took vows to Freemasonry. In the agrarian world of the colonies, a landscape largely limited to church, home, and farm, fraternal ties carried outsized influence. Freemasonic ideals, which included religious inclusivism, separation of church and state, and belief in the sanctity of the individual, forged a powerful bond and shared outlook among some of the founders, including a wide range of generals and signers of the Constitution. Baigent and Leigh, in what I consider a stretch, even suggest that Masonic sympathies blunted British commanders' fighting resolve against the colonists. Masonry's history, as well as its influence, is a pastiche with no neat lines, as the authors grasp. One problem is that Freemasons themselves often sought a single coherent heritage, a simple unaltered skein of tradition extending from pre-Christian times to the present day. In fact, Freemasonry is rather like a ball of twine, ensnarled by a playful kitten. It consists of numerous skeins, which must be disentangled before its various origins can be discerned. In that vein, the authors also probe connections between Freemasonry and Rosicrucianism, a clandestine thought movement that emerged in Europe in 1614. Calling themselves an invisible college, the Rosicrucians wrote in praise of inner development and mysticism, while prophesying the dawn of a new era of education and enlightenment. There exists a tantalizing confluence of philosophy and timing in the emergence of Rosicrucianism and Freemasonry. The first obvious literary and journal references to Freemasonry arrived less than a generation later. Shared values between Rosicrucianism and Masonry include radical ecumenism, rejection of aristocratic privilege and theocracy, ennobling of the individual spiritual search, belief in initiatory rites and rituals, use of alchemical and occult symbolism, and a sense of social polity, including the founding of hospitals and free schools. A shared origin between Rosicrucianism and Freemasonry is both tantalizing and reasonable, though still theoretical. It is not even clear that a secret brotherhood of Rosicrucians existed beyond a few manuscripts, which may have been produced by esoteric thinkers and provocateurs who emerged from the final stages of the Renaissance occult revival. This is why I call Rosicrucianism a thought movement, one that may have taken more formalized shape within the lodges of Masonry. The uncertainty of all these threads can be exasperating, but the surrounding questions should be treated patiently. Suppressed groups sometimes go underground and, on occasion, gain the final word through the endurance of their ideas, even when the original persecution was particularly brutal, as with the Templars. The destruction of the Templars in the early 1300s serves as a reminder that powerful institutions often project their flaws onto weaker ones, which allows the powerful to persecute the vulnerable for the former's faults or selfish interests. The Templars played a major role in the Crusades, both financially and martially. But when those conflicts ended in the late 13th century, the Knights' purpose as a combat and financial order was unclear. The French monarchy and the Vatican regarded the Templars as a potential rival. In a push to reassert control over banking and military mechanisms, the papacy decimated the Knights with accusations of heresy, leading to forced confessions, jailing, and in many cases, torture and death. For generations, this kind of religiously sanctioned persecution was directed against many of Europe's outsiders, in particular Jews, accused witches, Romani, and Gnostics. The more lurid accusations against the Templars included infanticide, sexual perversions, ritual abuse, and the worshipping of a disembodied head called Baphomet, later associated with the Sabbatic goat and sometimes the figure of Satan. This catalog of accusations got recycled over time, most recently in the satanic abuse scandals that swept the U.S. and England in the 1980s. During the satanic panic, everyday people, some with occult ties and tastes, but most with none, got smeared by religionists, local authorities, and self-styled experts with trumped-up charges of ritual and child abuse, in many cases leading to shattered lives and sometimes criminal prosecution. As in earlier eras, it is worth noting the surrounding social circumstances. Traditional institutions, including the Catholic Church and the Boy Scouts of America, were denying and underreporting cases of child abuse within their ranks, while defenseless librarians who practiced Wicca had to fear for life and livelihood. One of the historical lessons of the Templars is whenever a wave of accusation is directed against a marginalized group, look for antecedents within dominant institutions, whose ills often get displaced onto more vulnerable segments of society. This is tragically playing out today in violence against accused witches in economically strained parts of the world. As I write these words during the 2020 pandemic, the need for vigilance is all too clear. Did the Knights Templar fall victim to suppression only to reemerge as Freemasonry, the most influential esoteric movement of modern life? There is no obvious answer. But Baigent and Leigh's quest highlights a powerful principle. Past is never as far from present as it seems. Mitch Horowitz, May 2020. Introduction. In Britain during the last few years, Freemasonry has become both a favorite topic of conversation and a cherished issue of debate. Indeed, Mason baiting bids fair to become something of a full-fledged blood sport here, rather like priest baiting in Ireland. With scarcely disguised exuberance and a virtually audible tally-ho, the newspapers swoop on each new Masonic scandal, each new allegation of Masonic corruption. Church synods ponder the compatibility of Freemasonry with Christianity. In order to goad political opponents, local councils propose motions that would compel Freemasons to declare themselves. At parties, Freemasonry crops up with a frequency exceeded probably only by Britain's intelligence services and the CIA. Television, too, has made its contribution, conducting at least one late-night symposium on the subject and actually managing to poke its cameras into the beast's ultimate lair, Grand Lodge. On failing to find a dragon, the commentators seemed to feel less relief than an aggrieved sulkiness at having somehow been cheated. In the meantime, of course, people have remained fascinated. One need only pronounce the word Freemasonry in a pub, restaurant, hotel lobby, or other public place to see heads twitch, faces swivel attentively, ears fine-tune themselves to eavesdrop. Each new exposé is devoured with an eagerness, even a glee, usually reserved for royal gossip or for the salacious. This book is not an exposé. It does not address itself to the role or the activities, real or imagined, of Freemasonry in contemporary society. It does not attempt to investigate allegations of conspiracy or corruption. Neither, of course, is it an apology for Freemasonry. We are not Freemasons ourselves, and we have no vested interest in exculpating the institution from the charges leveled against it. Our orientation has been wholly historical. We have endeavored to track down the antecedents of Freemasonry, to establish its true origins, to chart its evolution and development, to assess its influence on British and American culture during its own formative years, culminating with the late 18th century. We have also tried to address the question of why Freemasonry, nowadays so instinctively regarded with suspicion, with derision, with irony and condescension, should ever have come to enjoy the currency it did, and for that matter still does, despite its detractors. In the process, however, we have inevitably been obliged to confront the kind of questions that loom in the public mind today and are so often posed by the media. Is Freemasonry corrupt? Is it, even more sinisterly, a vast international conspiracy dedicated to some obscure and, if secrecy is a barometer of villainy, nefarious end? Is it a conduit for perks, favors, influence, and power broking in the heart of such institutions as the city and the police? Most important of all, perhaps, is it truly inimical to Christianity? Such questions are not directly pertinent to the book that follows, but they are of understandable general concern. It will not be inappropriate, therefore, if we offer here the answers to them that emerged in the course of our enquiries. One has attained a measure of wisdom when, instead of exclaiming et tu, Brute, one nods ruefully and says, yes, it figures. Given human nature, it would be surprising if there were not at least some degree of corruption in public and private institutions, and if some of this corruption did not involve Freemasonry. We would argue, however, that such corruption says less about Freemasonry itself than about the ways in which Freemasonry, like any other such structure, can be abused. Greed, self-aggrandizement, favoritism, and other such ills have been endemic to human society since the emergence of civilization. They have availed themselves of and operated through every available channel, blood kinship, a shared past, bonds formed in school or in the armed forces, mutual interest, simple friendship, as well, of course, as race, religion, and political affiliation. Freemasonry is accused, for example, of making special dispensations for its own. In the Christianized West, until very recently, a man could expect from his fellows precisely the same special dispensation simply by virtue of his membership in the Freemasonry of Christianity, by virtue, in other words, of not being a Hindu, a Muslim, a Buddhist, or a Jew. Freemasonry is only one of many channels whereby corruption and favoritism can flourish. But if Freemasonry did not exist, corruption and favoritism would flourish all the same. Corruption and favoritism can be found in schools, in regiments, in corporations, in governmental bodies and political parties, in sects and churches, in innumerable other organizations. None of these is in itself intrinsically reprehensible. No one would think of condemning an entire political party or an entire church because certain of its members were corrupt or more sympathetically disposed towards other members than towards outsiders. No one would condemn the family as an institution because it tends to foster nepotism. In any moral consideration of the matter, it is necessary to exercise an understanding of elementary psychology and a modicum of common sense. Institutions are only as virtuous or as culpable as the individuals who compose them. If an institution can be considered corrupt in any intrinsic sense at all, it can be considered so only if it profits from the corruption of its members. This might apply to, say, a military dictatorship, to certain totalitarian or single-party states, but it is hardly applicable to Freemasonry. No one has ever suggested that Freemasonry ever gained anything through the transgressions of its brethren. On the contrary, the transgressions of individual Freemasons are entirely selfish and self-serving. Freemasonry as a whole suffers from such transgressions, as does Christianity from the transgressions of its adherents. In the question of corruption, then, Freemasonry is not in itself a culprit, but on the contrary, another victim of unscrupulous men who are prepared to exploit it along with anything else for their own ends. A more valid question is the compatibility, or lack thereof, between Freemasonry and Christianity. By its very nature, this question at least implies an attempt to confront what Freemasonry actually is, rather than the ways in which it can be exploited or abused. Ultimately, however, this question too is spurious. As is well known, Freemasonry does not purport to be a religion, only to address itself to certain principles or truths, which might in some sense be construed as religious or perhaps spiritual. It may offer a species of methodology, but it does not pretend to offer a theology. This distinction will become clearer in the chapters that follow. For the moment, it will be sufficient to make two points in connection with the current antipathy towards Freemasonry on the part of the Anglican Church. Amidst the Church's present preoccupation with Freemasonry in her ranks, these points are generally overlooked. Both are crucial. In the first place, Freemasonry and the Anglican Church have cohabited congenially since the beginning of the 17th century. Indeed, they have done more than cohabited, they have worked in tandem. Most of the important Anglican ecclesiastics of the last four centuries have issued from the Lodge. Some of the most eloquent and influential Freemasons have issued from the ministry. At no time prior to the last 10 or 15 years has the Church ever inveighed against Freemasonry, ever perceived any incompatibility between Freemasonry and its own theological principles. Freemasonry has not changed. The Church would argue that it has not changed either, at least in its fundamental tenets. Why then, if there has never been any conflict in the past, should there be conflict now? The answer to that question, we would suggest, lies less with Freemasonry than with the attitudes and mentalities of certain contemporary churchmen. The second point worth considering is, if anything, even more decisive. The official head of the Anglican Church is the British monarch. Since James II was deposed in 1688, the monarch's theological status, or credentials, have never been subject to question. And yet, since the beginning of the 17th century, the British monarchy has also been closely involved in Freemasonry. At least six kings, as well as numerous princes of the blood and prince consorts, have been Freemasons. Would this be possible if there were indeed some theological incompatibility between Freemasonry and the Church? To argue such incompatibility is tantamount, in effect, to impugning the religious integrity of the monarchy. Ultimately, we would maintain, the current controversy surrounding Freemasonry is a storm in a teacup. A number of non-issues or spurious issues inflated far beyond the status they actually deserve. It is tempting to be flip and suggest that people have nothing better to do than manufacture such tenuous grounds for controversy. Unfortunately, they do have better things to do. Certainly, the Anglican Church, with incipient schism in its ranks and a disastrously shrinking congregation, could deploy its energy and resources more constructively than in orchestrating crusades against a supposed enemy, which in fact is not an enemy at all. And while it is perfectly appropriate, even desirable, for the media to ferret out corruption, we would all be better served if the corrupt individuals themselves were called to account, rather than the institution of which they happen to be members. At the same time, it must be acknowledged that Freemasonry itself has done little to improve its own image in the public eye. Indeed, by its obsessive secrecy and its stubborn defensiveness, it has only reinforced the conviction that it has something to hide. How little it does in fact have to hide will become apparent in the course of this book. If anything, it has more to be proud of than it does to conceal. Prelude. 10 years ago, in the spring of 1978, while researching the Knights Templar for a projected television documentary, we became intrigued by the Order's history in Scotland. The surviving documentation was meager, but Scotland possessed an even greater wealth of legend and tradition about the Templars than did most other places. There were also some very real mysteries, unexplained enigmas, which, in the absence of reliable records, orthodox historians had scarcely attempted to account for. If we could penetrate these mysteries, if we could find even a kernel of truth behind the legends and traditions, the implications would be enormous, not only for the history of the Templars, but extending far beyond as well. A woman we knew had recently moved with her husband to live in Aberdeen. On a visit back to London, they recounted to us a story they had heard from another man who had worked for a time in a hotel in a small tourist community, formerly a Victorian watering spot, on the western shore of Loch Awe in the Highlands of Argyll. Loch Awe is a large inland lake some 25 miles from Oban. The lake itself is 28 miles long and varies in width for the most part from half a mile to a mile. It is dotted with just under 24 islands of various sizes, some natural, others man-made, and formerly connected to the shore by causeways of now submerged stones and timber. Like Loch Ness, Loch Awe is supposed to contain a monster, the Beagh Mór, described as a large serpent-like creature with a horse's head and 12 legs sheathed in scales. On one of the islands, according to the story our informant had heard, there were a number of Templar graves, more than would make sense in the context of accepted history, for the Templars were not known to have been active around Argyll or the Western Highlands. On the same island, moreover, there were supposedly the ruins of a Templar preceptory, which did not figure in any of our lists of Templar holdings. As we received it at third hand, the name of the island sounded something like Innis Shield, but we could not be sure of that, still less of the spelling. These fragments of information, even though unconfirmed and frustratingly vague, were tantalizing. Like many researchers before us, we were familiar with nebulous accounts of bands of Templars surviving the official persecution and dissolution of their order between 1307 and 1314. We were familiar with stories that one such enclave of knights, fleeing their tormentors on the continent and in England, had found a refuge in Scotland, and at least for a time had perpetuated something of their original institutions. But we were also aware that most such traditions had originated with the Freemasons of the 18th century, who sought to establish for themselves a pedigree extending directly back to the Templars of four centuries before. In consequence, we were extremely skeptical. We knew that no accepted evidence for any Templar survival in Scotland existed, and that even modern Freemasonry tended in general to dismiss all claims to the contrary as sheer invention and wishful thinking. And yet, the tale of the island and the lake continued to haunt us. We had planned a research trip to Scotland for that summer anyway, albeit far to the east, Should we not perhaps make a leisurely westward detour, if only to disprove the story we had heard and exorcise it once and for all from our minds? Accordingly, we decided to extend our trip by a few days and return via Argyle. As we descended on Loch Awe from the north, we immediately saw, at the head of it, masked by serried firs, the large 15th century Campbell Castle of Killachern. We proceeded down the eastern side of the lake. After some 15 miles, an island appeared to our right, perhaps 50 yards from the shore. On it stood the ruins of the 13th century castle of Innis Channel, which was occupied around 1308 by Robert the Bruce's close friend, ally, and brother-in-law, Sir Neil Campbell, and which for the next century and a half had been Clan Campbell's primary seat. Then, when a new castle was built at Inverary, at the upper reaches of Loch Fyne, Innis Channel was turned into a prison for the enemies of the Campbells, or, as they had by then become, the Earls of Argyll. A mile south of Innis Channel, there was a smaller island, just visible from the road through the trees and shrubs fringing the shore. When we stopped, we could see the remains on it of a structure of some sort, and stones which appeared to be graves. On the opposite side of the road was the hamlet of Port Innis Sherrick. The island itself, according to the maps we consulted, was variously called Innis Sereich or Innis Si Ramhach. We promptly pole-vaulted to the conclusion that this was the Innis Shield we had been seeking. The island lay some 40 yards from the shore, along which there were a number of boats, most of them obviously functional and in regular use. Hoping to rent one and row out to the island, we inquired at the general store in Port Innis Sherrick. There, however, we encountered a curious evasiveness. Although the area was postcard scenic and must have relied to at least some degree on the tourist trade, we were not made to feel in any way welcome. Why, we were asked guardedly, did we want to rent a boat? To explore the island, we replied. No boat was available for rental, we were told. People did not rent boats. Could we hire someone, boat and all, to row us out to the island? No, we were told without any explanation or elaboration. That was not possible either. Frustrated, and all the more convinced that Innis Sereich must contain something of relevance, we wandered on foot along the shore. From across the intervening strip of water, the island beckoned tauntingly, almost within stone-throwing distance, yet inaccessible. We discussed the possibility of swimming out to it, and were debating the likely coldness of the water, when, just north of the hamlet, we encountered an elderly couple with a tent erected beside a caravan. After an exchange of casual courtesies, they invited us to share a cup of tea with them. They too, it transpired, came from London. For the last 15 years or so, however, they had been coming to this spot every summer, setting up their caravan and fishing along Loch Awe. Inside their caravan, we had to squeeze past the end of a table onto a long bench. To one side, there was a smaller table, or flat surface of some kind, used probably for preparing food. On this, an old book lay open, at a page with what appeared to be an engraving of a Masonic tomb. We noted certain Masonic symbols and a skull and crossbones. Subsequently, we realized that what we had seen might have been a Masonic tracing board of the kind used in the 18th century. In any case, we inquired quite casually about the prevalence of Freemasonry in the area, whereupon the book was quickly but discreetly closed, and our query was deflected with a shrug. We asked our hosts if they could tell us anything about the island. "Not much," they replied. "Yes, there were some ruins of some sort out there, and yes, there were some graves, though not many, and not that old. In fact," the couple told us, "most of the graves were fairly recent. But the island," they said, "did seem to enjoy some sort of special significance. They did not venture to suggest what it might be. Bodies, they reported, were sometimes brought there for burial from considerable distances, sometimes even flown across the Atlantic from the United States. Quite clearly, this had nothing to do with 13th or 14th century Templars. Nevertheless, it was intriguing. It might, of course, involve nothing more than a tradition of local families whose descendants, in accordance with some established ritual or custom, were buried in native soil. On the other hand, there might just possibly be something more to the matter, something pertaining, perhaps, to Freemasonry, which our hosts were patently loath to discuss. They had a boat of their own, which they used for fishing. We asked if we could hire it, or if they would row us out to the island. At first, they were a little reluctant, repeating their assertion that we would find nothing of interest, but at last, perhaps infected by our curiosity, the man offered to row us out while his wife prepared another pot of tea. The island proved disappointing. It was extremely small, no more than 30 yards across. It did contain the ruins of a diminutive chapel, but these consisted of nothing more than some sections of wall jutting a few feet up from the soil. There was no way of ascertaining whether the dilapidated, mossy remains were indeed once a Templar chapel. They were certainly too small to have been a preceptory. As for the graves, most of them were, as we'd been told, of comparatively recent date. The earliest dated from 1732, the latest from the 1960s. Certain family names occurred, Jameson, McCallum, Sinclair. On one stone of First World War vintage, there was a Masonic square and compasses. The island obviously had something to do with local families, some of whom probably incidentally were involved in Freemasonry. But there was nothing that could be construed as Templar, certainly nothing to support the account we had heard of a Templar graveyard. If there was any mystery about the place at all, it appeared to be both local and minor. Thwarted and frustrated, we decided to find a bed and breakfast for the night, collect our thoughts, and, if possible, work out how the information we'd received could have been so flagrantly askew. We proceeded down the eastern shore of Loch Awe, towards the road that led to Loch Fyne, and thence to Glasgow. By this time, dusk was approaching. We stopped at a village named Kilmartin, past the southern end of the loch, and asked where we might find a place to stay. We were directed to a large converted house a few miles beyond the town, near some ancient Celtic cairns. Having checked in there, we returned to Kilmartin for a drink at the pub. Although larger than Port Inis Sheerach, Kilmartin was still little more than a hamlet, with a petrol station, a pub, a recommendable restaurant, and some 24 houses all concentrated on one side of the road. On the other side was a large parish church with a tower. The whole structure had either been built or extensively restored during the last century. We did not expect to discover anything of consequence at Kilmartin. It was only idle curiosity that led us to enter the churchyard. But there, not on an island in a lake, but in the grounds of a parish church, were rank after strictly regimented rank of badly weathered flatstones. There were upwards of 80 of them. Some had sunk so deeply into the ground that the grass was already growing over them. Others were still intact and clearly defined among the more modern raised tombs and family burial plots. Many of the stones, particularly those of later date and better condition, were adorned with elaborate carvings, decorative motifs, family or clan devices, a welter of Masonic symbols. Others had been worn completely smooth. But what interested us were those that bore no decoration save a single, simple, and austere straight sword. These swords varied in size, and sometimes, even if only slightly, in design. According to the practice of the time, the dead man's sword would be laid on the stone. Its outline would be incised and then chiseled. The carving would thus reflect precisely the dimensions, shape, and style of the original weapon. It was this stark, anonymous sword that marked the earliest of the stones, those most badly worn, weathered, and eroded. On the later stones, names and dates were added to the sword, then decorative motifs, family and clan devices, Masonic symbols. There were even some women's graves. It seemed we had found the Templar graveyard we were seeking. The sheer existence of the ranked graves in Kilmartin must surely have elicited questions from visitors other than ourselves. Who were the fighting men buried there? Why were there so many of them in such an out-of-the-way place? What explanations were offered by local authorities and antiquarians? The plaque at the church shed only meager light on the matter. All it said was that the earliest of the slabs dated from around 1300, the latest from the early 18th century. Most, the plaque concluded, are the work of a group of sculptors working around Loch Awe in the late 14th to 15th centuries. What group of sculptors? If they were known to have constituted a group in any formal or organized sense, as clearly seemed to be the case, surely something more must be known about them. And was it not rather unusual for sculptors to congregate in groups, unless for some specific purpose or under some specific aegis, that of a royal or aristocratic court, for example, or of a religious order? In any case, if the plaque was vague about who had carved the stones, it was worse than vague about who had been buried under them. It said nothing. Whatever the impressions conveyed by books, films, and romanticized history, swords were a rare and expensive commodity in the early 14th century. Every fighting man did not, as a matter of course, own one. Many were too poor and had to use axes or spears. Nor, for that matter, was there much of an arms industry in Scotland at the time, and particularly in this part of Scotland. Most of the blades then in use in the country had to be imported, which made them all the more costly. Given these facts, the graves at Kilmartin could not have been those of ordinary rank-and-file soldiery, the 14th-century equivalent of cannon fodder. On the contrary, the men commemorated by the stones had to be of some social consequence, well-to-do individuals, affluent gentry, if not full-fledged knights. But was it plausible that men of wealth and social status would be buried anonymously? Far more than today, prominent individuals of the 14th century plumed themselves on their family, their ancestry, their lineage, their pedigree, and this was particularly true in Scotland, where clan affiliations and relationships enjoyed especial significance, and where identity and blood descent were given a sometimes obsessive emphasis. Such things were insistently stressed in life and duly memorialized in death. Finally, why were the earliest of the graves at Kilmartin, the anonymous graves marked only by the straight sword, so lacking in all Christian symbolism, lacking even in anything as basic as a cross? In an age where the church's hegemony over Western Europe was virtually unchallenged, only tombs with effigies on them were left unadorned by Christian iconography, and such tombs were invariably placed in chapels or churches. The tombs at Kilmartin, however, were situated outdoors, were devoid of effigies, yet still lacked religious adornment. Was the hilt of the sword itself intended to denote the cross, or were the graves those of men perceived in one sense or another not to have been properly Christian? From 1296 on, Sir Neil Campbell, Bruce's friend, ally, and eventual brother-in-law, had been Bailey of Kilmartin and Loch Awe, and since Kilmartin itself had been one of his seats, it would have been reasonable to suppose that the earliest of the graves there were those of Sir Neil's men. But that would not serve to explain their anonymity, nor the absence of Christian symbolism. Unless, of course, the men who served under Sir Neil were not native to the area, not conventionally Christian, and had some reason to keep their identities concealed, even in death. During the course of our research, We had explored most of the ruins of Templar preceptories still surviving in England, and many of those in France, Spain, and the Middle East. We were familiar, almost to the point of satiation, with the varieties of Templar sculpture, Templar devices, Templar embellishment, and, in the few instances where they could still be found, Templar graves. Those graves displayed the same characteristics as the graves in Kilmartin. They were invariably simple, austere, devoid of decoration. Frequently, though not always, they were marked by the simple, straight sword. They were always anonymous. Indeed, it was the very anonymity of Templar graves that distinguished them from the elaborate inscriptions, decorations, monuments, and sarcophagi of other nobles. The Templars were, after all, a monastic order, a society of warrior monks, soldier mystics. Even if only in theory, they had supposedly renounced, as individuals at least, the trappings and pretensions of the material world. When one entered the temple, one effectively relinquished one's identity, becoming subsumed by the order. The stark, unadorned image of the straight sword was supposed to bear testimony to the ascetic, self-abnegating piety which obtained within the order's ranks. Historians, especially Masonic historians, had long sought either to prove or disprove definitively the alleged survival of the Templars in Scotland after the order had been officially suppressed elsewhere. But these historians had looked for and in documentation, not on the ground. Not surprisingly, they had found no conclusive evidence one way or the other, because most of the relevant documentation had been lost, destroyed, suppressed, falsified, or deliberately discredited. On the other hand, historians of Argyll, who were aware of the graves at Kilmartin, had had no reason to think of the Templars, since the Templars were not known to have been active or even present in the region. So far as their European bases were concerned, the Templars were strongest in France, Spain, Germany, Italy, and England. Such holdings as they officially possessed in Scotland were, at least according to readily accessible records, far to the east in the vicinity of Edinburgh and Aberdeen. There would have been no grounds for supposing an enclave of the order to have existed in Argyll unless one were specifically looking for it. Thus, it appeared to us, the graves at Kilmartin had preserved their secret from historical researchers of both camps, chroniclers of the Templars and of Freemasonry on the one hand, and on the other, chroniclers of the immediate region, who had no reason even to think of Templars. Needless to say, we were excited by our discovery, and we felt it to be all the more significant because it seemed to pertain not only to the Templars. There appeared to be a coherent pattern linking the earliest graves at Kilmartin, those we supposed were Templar, and the later ones adorned with family blazons, clan devices, and Masonic symbolism. The earlier graves seemed to grade gradually into the later ones, or rather, the later ones seemed, by a process of assimilation and accretion, to have evolved out of the earlier. The motifs were essentially the same, only becoming more elaborately embellished with the years. The later decorations did not simply replace the straight sword, but were added to it. The graves at Kilmartin seemed to offer their own mute but eloquent testimony to an ongoing development, to bear witness to a story spanning four centuries, from the beginning of the 14th to the beginning of the 18th. In the pub that evening, we attempted to decipher the chronicle in the stones. Could we really have stumbled upon an enclave of refugee Templars who, on the dissolution of their order, had found a haven in what was then the wilderness of Argyll? Might they have taken in yet more refugees from abroad? Argyll, though difficult to reach by land in the early 14th century, was readily accessible by sea, and the Templars possessed a substantial fleet which was never found by their persecutors in Europe. Had the green forest-shagged hills and glens around us once housed an entire community of white-mantled knights like a lost tribe or lost city in an adventure story? And had the order here perpetuated itself its rituals and observances. But if it were to perpetuate itself beyond a single generation, the Knights would have had to secularize, or at least would have had to abrogate their vow of chastity and marry. Was this perhaps part of the process to which the stones bore witness, the gradual intermarriage of refugee Templars and members of the clan system? And out of that alliance between the Templars and the clans of Argyle, might there have originated one of the skeins that were to lead to later Freemasonry? In the stones of Kilmartin, might we not perhaps be confronted by a concrete answer to one of the most perplexing questions in European history, the origins and development of Freemasonry itself? We did not include any of what we had discovered in our film, which had by that time already been partially scripted. Its orientation, moreover, was primarily towards the Templars in the Holy Land and France, and if our findings in Scotland proved valid, they would, we felt, warrant a film of their own. For the moment, however, all we had was a plausible theory, with, in the absence of immediately accessible documentation, no way of confirming it. In the meantime, other projects, other commitments, had begun to intervene, and our discoveries in Scotland were shunted ever further into the background. We did not lose sight of them, however. They continued to haunt us and to exercise a hold on our imaginations. During the ensuing 9 years, we proceeded, if only in a desultory manner, to gather additional information. We consulted the work of Marion Campbell, probably the region's most prominent local historian, and established a personal correspondence with her. She advised us to be wary of any premature conclusions, but she was intrigued by our theory. If there were no records of the Templars holding land in Argyle, she said, this was more likely to indicate an absence of records than an absence of Templars. And she found it indeed possible that the arrival of Templars in the region might explain the sudden appearance of the anonymous straight sword amid the more traditional, more familiar Celtic embellishments and motifs. We also consulted such additional published work as existed on the stones at Kilmartin, from the researches of 19th-century antiquarians to a more recent opus published in 1977 under the auspices of the Royal Commission on the Ancient and Historical Monuments of Scotland. To our disappointment, most such material concentrated primarily on the later, more elaborately embellished stones. The earlier stones, marked by the single anonymous straight sword, were largely ignored, if only because nothing was known about them and no one had anything much to say. Nevertheless, certain important facts did emerge. We learned from Marion Campbell, for example, that the stones in the churchyard at Kilmartin had not originally been situated there. Some had been inside the church, or rather inside a much earlier church. Others had been scattered throughout the surrounding countryside and only later relocated. We also learned that Kilmartin was not the only such graveyard in the region. In fact, there were no fewer than 16. But Kilmartin did seem to have the greatest concentration of older stones, marked by the anonymous straight sword. Only three firm conclusions could be drawn. The first was that the background of the carvings, and especially the older carvings, remained a mystery. The second, on which virtually everyone agreed, was that these earlier carvings dated from the beginning of the 14th century, the time of Robert the Bruce in Scotland and the suppression of the Knights Templar elsewhere in Europe. The third conclusion was that the graves with the anonymous straight sword represented a new style, a new development in the region, which had appeared suddenly and inexplicably, although Templar holdings elsewhere had been using the design prior to its sudden appearance in Argyle. We had already seen it in a context predating the earliest stones at Kilmartin, as close to home as Temple Garway in Herefordshire, which was indisputably Templar. In Incised Effigial Slabs in Latin Christendom, 1976, the late F.A. Greenhill published the results of a lifetime spent tabulating medieval graves all over Europe, from the Baltic to the Mediterranean, from Riga to Cyprus. Among the 4,460 graves he lists and describes, he found some without inscriptions, but they were extremely rare. Military gravestones were even rarer. In England, for example, he had found only 4, not counting the one at Garway, of which he was unaware. In Ireland, he had found only 1. In all of Scotland except Argyll, he had again found only 1. In Argyll, he had found 60 anonymous military gravestones. It was thus clear that the concentration of stones at Kilmartin and adjacent sites was genuinely unique. Almost equally unique was the extraordinary concentration of Masonic graves. Another important source of evidence for us was the Israeli Archaeological Survey Association, which had excavated the old Templar castle of Athlit in the Holy Land. Athlit had been built in 1218 and finally abandoned, along with all the other remnants of the Crusaders' Kingdom of Jerusalem, in 1291. When the castle was excavated, it proved to contain a graveyard with upwards of 100 stones. Most, of course, had been very badly weathered, and shallow incisions, such as the straight swords we had found in Scotland, had not survived. But a few more deeply chiseled designs had, and these were particularly interesting. One was on the stone of a Templar maritime commander, perhaps an admiral, and consisted of a large anchor. One, though very severely worn, still showed a mason's square and plumb stone. One, believed to be that of the master of the Templar Masons, bore a cross with decorations, a mason's square and maul. With only 2 exceptions, these are the earliest known incidents of gravestones bearing Masonic devices. One of the exceptions is Romps and dates from 1263. The other, of comparable age, is also in France at the former Templar preceptory of Bure-les-Templiers in the Côte d'Or. Here, then, was persuasive evidence to support the chronicle in stone we had tried to decipher at Kilmartin, a chronicle which, if we had deciphered it correctly, attested to an important early connection between the Templars and what was later to evolve into Freemasonry. In our enthusiasm at our discovery, we had forgotten our original purpose in coming to Argyll, the account of a Templar graveyard on an island in Loch Awe. We had assumed the account had become garbled and actually referred to Kilmartin. What we did not know at the time was that we had visited the wrong island. In the autumn of 1987, we returned to Argyll and Loch Awe. By this time, we had learned that the island which prompted our previous visit was not Inishsherock, but Inishale, some miles to the north. In fact, we had passed it the first time without even noticing it. But if Inishale was the right island, it proved no more fruitful than the wrong island we had visited 9 years before, although we had no difficulty on this occasion in hiring a boat. We did find the ruins of a church dating from the relevant period, the early 14th century, but the structure was clearly not Templar. The last regular service conducted in the place, we learned, had been in 1736, and by the end of the century, it was already derelict. When we saw it, the interior was a matted tangle of grass, weeds, and nettles, which covered a number of hopelessly worn and cracked grave slabs lining the floor. Outside, there were more slabs, the older ones so sunken and overgrown as to be scarcely visible, although others of later date were still upright. Among the most recent graves were those of the 11th Duke of Argyll, who had died in 1973, and Brigadier Reginald Fellows, CBE, MC, and Bar, Légion d'Honneur, who had died in 1982. The man from whom we had hired our boat reported that he often crossed to Inishale and explored the island. He told us of a slab he had only just discovered, not yet recorded by the Royal Commission. Suspecting there might be others, we probed with our pocket knives and indeed found some, but there was nothing to be gleaned from them. If the site is ever properly cleaned, These slabs may yet have much of consequence to reveal. Our own amateurish and probably sloppy reconnaissance, however, revealed no suggestion of anything Templar. This was disappointing, but at least we now knew the truth about the hitherto elusive island. Elsewhere around Loch Awe, we found nothing any more conclusive than what existed at Kilmartin, vestiges which were very possibly Templar, which we could argue plausibly to be Templar, but which were not provably so. On a hill to the southeast of the loch, however, at the ruined 13th century church of Kilnuair, we found something curious. In the grass were slabs similar to the later ornately embellished slabs at Kilmartin. On one of these, the design was surmounted by an unmistakable Templar cross. But the cross was not part of the original, meticulously chiseled adornment. It had been clumsily carved into the stone, like graffiti, at some later date, perhaps as late as the 17th or 18th century. This could hardly be taken as evidence of Templars in the area. It did indicate, however, that someone thereabouts, at some subsequent time, had had some sort of interest in the Templars. We proceeded southwest, past the imposing fortress of Castle Sween on the loch of the same name. In the early 14th century, Loch Sween had been a strategically crucial port on the sea route running from Ulster through the Isles of Islay and Jura, and its castle, besieged and captured by Bruce around 1308 to 1309, had been the major strong point of the region. The castle itself, reputedly the oldest stone castle on the Scottish mainland, was obviously a maritime citadel with its own harbor for galleys. Fallen stones, some of them dressed, indicated where a breakwater, an inner harbor, and a jetty had been situated. If, at the time of the suppression of their order, Templars from Europe had fled by sea to Scotland, this would have been perhaps their most likely disembarkation. Beyond the castle lay the sea, with the Isle of Jura across the sound to the west, its hills cloaked in cloud. Here, on the coast, stood the small ruined 13th century chapel of Kilmory, which had ministered to the once thriving maritime parish. Inside and around the chapel, there were some 40 grave slabs of the same period and kind we had learned to recognize from Kilmartin. But there were two other items of greater significance, providing evidence which was perhaps less copious than we would have liked, but which was of sufficient caliber to confirm our theory. Templar churches invariably had a cross either carved above the entrance or standing freely outside. The cross, whether simple or embellished, was always of distinctive design, equal-armed, with the end of each arm wider than its base. Inside the chapel of Kilmory stood just such a cross, dating from before the 14th century. Had this cross been found anywhere else in Europe, no one would have had any hesitation in recognizing it as Templar and ascribing the chapel to the order. Furthermore, inside the church lay a 14th century grave slab, incised with a sailing galley, an armed figure, and another Templar cross. This one worked into a floreate design. But there was more. On that same 14th century grave slab was something that reassured us that our decipherment of the chronicle in stone had not only been tenable, but was, in its general outline, accurate. Above the head of the armed figure with its Templar cross was carved a Masonic set square. It was now safe to say that there were Templars on Loch Sween, and that Kilmory had almost certainly been a Templar chapel, not purpose-built for the order, but at any rate taken over by them. Given this evidence, it was not just possible, but probable, that the graves at Kilmartin and elsewhere in the region were indeed Templar. Part 1. Robert Bruce, heir to Celtic Scotland. Chapter 1. Bruce and his struggle for power. On May 18, 1291, Acre, the last bastion of the Western Crusaders in the Holy Land, fell to the Saracens, and the Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem, born of the First Crusade nearly 2 centuries before, finally and irrevocably collapsed. Thus ended the great European dream of a Christian Middle East. The resonant and sacred sites of Scripture, from Egypt through Palestine to Lebanon and Syria, were to remain in Islamic hands, effectively off-limits to Christians until Napoleon's time, some 5 centuries later. With the loss of the Holy Land, the Knights Templar lost not only their primary sphere of military operations, but also their primary raison d'être. In military terms, at least, they could no longer justify their existence. Their kindred military religious orders had bases elsewhere and other crusades to fight. The Knights Hospitaller of St. John were to establish themselves first on Rhodes, then on Malta, and to spend the next 3 centuries wresting control of the Mediterranean for an ever more mercantile Christendom. The Teutonic Knights had already found their new vocation on the Baltic, exterminating the pagan tribes there and creating a Christian principality which extended from Prussia through Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia to the Gulf of Finland. The Spanish orders of Santiago, Calatrava, and Alcantara had yet to expel the Moors from the Iberian Peninsula, while the Portuguese Knights of Christ were to devote themselves increasingly to maritime exploration. Only the Templars, most wealthy, most powerful, and most prestigious of the orders, were left without a purpose and without a home. Their own ambition to establish a principality for themselves in the Long Duck was thwarted and remained stillborn. The decade and a half that followed the fall of Acre was to be a period of decline for the temple. Then, at dawn on Friday, October 13, 1307, Philippe IV of France ordered the arrest of all Templars in his domains. During the next 7 years, the Inquisition moved on to the center of the stage to finish what the French king had started. Templars throughout Europe were imprisoned, tried, interrogated, tortured, and executed. In 1312, the Order of the Temple was officially dissolved by the Pope. In 1314, the last Grand Master of the Order, Jacques de Molay, was burned at the stake, and the Temple effectively ceased to exist. Robert Bruce's career spans this crucial period precisely. He first appeared in a position of prominence in 1292, a year after the fall of Acre, when he became Earl of Carrick. His life attained its climax with the Battle of Bannockburn in 1314, some 3 months after Jacques de Molay's death. In 1306, a year before the persecution of the Temple began, Bruce himself had been excommunicated and was to remain at odds with the papacy for another 12 years. Because he had ceased to be recognized by the Pope, it was impossible for Rome to treat with him or impose her will in his domains. In effect, the papal writ no longer ran in Scotland, or at least those parts of Scotland which Bruce controlled, and which lay therefore beyond the pale. And thus, in those parts of Scotland, the decree which abolished the temple elsewhere in Europe was not, in accordance with the strict letter of the law, applicable. If knights of the order, fleeing persecution on the continent, hoped to find a refuge anywhere, it would have been under Bruce's protection. A spate of archaic legends and traditions has for centuries linked Bruce with the Templars, even if the association between them has not been satisfactorily defined. The graves in Argyll provided persuasive evidence for these legends and traditions. They dated from the relevant period and were located in a region where it would have been natural for refugee Templars to seek safety. The closer one looks at Bruce, moreover, the clearer it becomes that he and the Templars had much in common. The Celtic Kingdom of Scotland. Bruce is usually perceived as the central figure in medieval Scotland's struggle for independence, but Bruce was intent on something more, something much more radical and much more ambitious than just thwarting English domination. What he sought was nothing less than the restoration of a uniquely Celtic kingdom with specifically Celtic institutions. These may even have included ritual human sacrifice. In medieval Ireland and Wales, even where England's Norman sovereigns had not established their sway, there was no centralized authority. Both countries were torn by internecine squabbles between a multitude of local princelings or chieftains and their clans. Scotland was the only Celtic realm with well-formed and independent political institutions at the beginning of the High Middle Ages. In Roman times, of course, Scotland had been dominated by the Picts, who continued to play a prominent role in Scottish history until the mid-9th century. But in the late 5th century, Celtic settlers from Ireland, particularly from Ulster, had begun to settle in the west of the country and to establish what is now called the Kingdom of the Dalriada, one of whose ancient strongholds was Dunad, just 3 miles from Kilmartin. For 350 years, the Dalriada in the west and the Picts elsewhere struggled for supremacy, each at intervals gaining a temporary ascendancy, then losing it again. Though often violent, the struggle was not always so. It was also cultural and dynastic, and there were periodic high-level intermarriages between the two peoples. By circa 843, however, the Dalriada had effectively triumphed. The Picts were not so much defeated militarily as subsumed. Pictish language and culture entirely, albeit gradually, disappeared, and Scotland, under the aegis of the Dalriada king, Kenneth MacAlpin, became a unified Celtic kingdom. Around 850, Kenneth was installed at Scone as monarch of all Scotland. There were still to be internal vicissitudes, intrigues, and strife of the kind immortalized by Shakespeare and Macbeth, but under Kenneth MacAlpin's descendant, David I, the feudal Kingdom of Scotland finally emerged in 1124, a quarter of a century after Western Crusaders had established the Latin Kingdom of Jerusalem. Although the Normans had first ventured into Scotland under William Rufus, son of William the Conqueror, there was no large-scale or successful Norman penetration until David's time. David himself was thoroughly Celtic, the son of the Celtic king Malcolm III. During his reign, however, large numbers of Norman and also Flemish knights were allowed into the country. So too was monasticism, chiefly under the auspices of the Cistercians. Nevertheless, Scotland remained a wholly Celtic kingdom, and there is evidence that much Celtic thought, both pagan and Christian, persisted there long after it had vanished from Ireland. Among the unique institutions created by David was the office, subsequently hereditary, of the royal steward of the realm, later called the Steward, the office from which the Stuart dynasty was to derive. The steward was a kind of hereditary manager of the royal household, or hereditary court chancellor, very similar to the so-called mayor of the palace in Merovingian France 3 centuries before. Just as the mayors of the palace eventually supplanted the Merovingians and formed the Carolingian dynasty, so in Scotland, the Stuarts, though more peacefully, were to supplant the dynasty of David. The first steward, Walter FitzAlan, was of Celtic Breton descent, the son of one Alan FitzFlald. Alan may also have been descended from a Scottish thane, Banquo of Lochaber, whose legend finds its way into Shakespeare's play. Among King David's entourage was a Norman knight, Robert de Bruce. David conferred upon him the Vale of Annan, which guarded the approaches to Scotland through Carlisle. He was also a close friend of the English king, Henry I, and held extensive lands in Yorkshire. Robert's family is generally believed to have come from Bruce or Bruy, now Brie, just south of Cherbourg. More recently, however, it has been suggested that he was in fact of Flemish origin, descended from Robert de Bruges, the wealthy castellan of that city 75 years before. Robert disappeared from Bruges in 1053, the year in which Mathilde of Flanders married William, Duke of Normandy. He may well have accompanied her into France, and then, 13 years later, accompanied her husband on the invasion of England. Although the Robert de Bruce of King David's time was of Norman and possibly Flemish descent, his great-grandson married David's great-granddaughter, the niece of the Celtic kings Malcolm IV and William I. The Robert Bruce, who was later to figure so prominently in Scottish history, could thus claim blood descent from the ancient Celtic royal house and eventually back to Kenneth MacAlpin of the Dalriada. And when Robert Bruce's daughter married Walter the Steward, or Stuart, the dynasty, later known as the Stuarts, was born. The Celtic element remained prevalent in Scottish society until the end of the 13th century. Thus, for example, the most influential noblemen in the realm were the 13 earls, or thanes, who derived their lineage and authority directly from the older kingdom of the Dalriada. Among those earls, the most important was the Earl of Fife, who exercised the hereditary right to place the new king on the throne during the coronation ceremony. The coronation itself was traditionally held at Scone, 2 miles up the Tay River from Perth, and the throne of the kingdom was built around the famous stone of Scone, supposedly brought to the site by Kenneth MacAlpin in 850. Scone itself had been a sacred or semi-sacred place since pre-Celtic Pictish times. Its central point was the Hill of Belief, now called Moot Hill. Here, in a ritual dating back beyond recorded history, a new monarch would be seated on a stone and invested with the regalia of his office, including probably a rod and a mantle. Thus would the king be wedded to the land, to the people he ruled, and to the earth goddess herself, often portrayed in animal guise. In the Irish version of the rite, a mare would be sacrificed and boiled in water in which the newly installed king bathed, while drinking the broth and eating the beast's flesh. In this way, it was believed, the fertility of the land and the people would be ensured. By the 12th century, in the wake of the Crusades, this archaic principle, the monarch's responsibility for the land's fertility, would be amalgamated with skeins of esoteric Judeo-Christian tradition to produce the corpus of poems now known as the Grail Romances. These, as we shall hear, were to have a very specific pertinence to Scotland. The coronation of Alexander III in 1249 was typical of the Celtic rites that prevailed in Scotland long after they had vanished elsewhere. When Alexander was seated on the throne at Scone, an aged Highland bard formally recited, in Gaelic, the new monarch's genealogy back through the Dalriada to the first Scotsman. As might be expected of a Celtic ruler, Alexander was always accompanied by a harpist. When he traveled, he would be preceded, as tradition decreed for a Celtic chieftain, by 7 women singing his glory and his pedigree, a flattering practice at first, no doubt, which must quickly have become both noisy and boring. Not surprisingly, in such a milieu, the church exercised only the most tenuous of holds. During the 9th century, Scotland seems briefly to have provided a refuge for surviving splinter groups of the Celtic Church in Ireland. Under one of these splinter groups, the Chelly Dee or Chaldees, a monastic system was established, but never came to wield the influence it did across the Irish Sea. Despite an influx of Cistercians in the 12th century, the Roman Church had all but disappeared. In Lothian, for example, no bishopric was to be found after circa 950, nor was any religious community to be founded in Strathclyde after that date. But the Celtic Kingdom of Scotland, which had obtained its apotheosis with Alexander III, was to die with him. In March 1286, returning one stormy night from a council at Edinburgh, the king became separated from his escort and was found the next morning with a broken neck. His demise was not only to precipitate a major internal crisis and a bitter struggle for the throne, it was also to provide England with an excuse for meddling on a hitherto unprecedented scale in Scottish affairs. The emergence of Bruce. Alexander died without sons. His only daughter, Margaret, was married to the King of Norway, and Scotland had no desire for a Norwegian ruler. Accordingly, a provisional government was formed, consisting of six guardians of the peace, the Earl of Fife as premier peer, the Earl of Buchan, James the Stuart, John Comyn, and the bishops of Glasgow and St. Andrews. Acting as a regency, this council decided to confer the crown on Margaret of Norway's daughter, also named Margaret, who was then an infant. It was arranged that the child, on attaining her maturity, would marry Prince Edward, subsequently Edward II of England. But in 1290, en route home from Norway, the young Margaret died, and the question of the Scottish succession was plunged into turmoil. More than a dozen candidates presented themselves as claimants to the throne, including John Balliol and the grandfather of Robert Bruce, known as the Competitor. So great was the danger of civil war that the Bishop of St. Andrews invited Edward I of England to arbitrate. Thus, the Norman monarchy of England received a mandate to intervene in the affairs of the Celtic Kingdom of Scotland. Edward wasted no time in turning this mandate to his own advantage. When he met with the Scottish claimants in 1291, he proceeded to claim suzerainty over Scotland for himself.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.